HarperCollins presents Gin and Phonics, My Journey Through Middle-Class Motherhood, via the occasional pub. Written and read by Clara Batten. This book is dedicated to my late father, Howard, my mother, Louise, my two children, Cressy and Monty, and my husband, Adam. Introduction. Hello, you. I don't mean to sound like some Hugh Grant character in a Richard Curtis rom-com. I'm literally saying hello. Because, if I'm honest, I never, not in a million years, thought I'd be here. Writing this book. Writing to you. Someone I've never met. I'm sure I'd want to meet you, given you've bought my book. Shit, I'm not saying that because I'm making money from you. What I mean is, the fact that you have an interest in buying this book probably means we're somewhat alike in many respects. Geez, not just an interest in buying this. You've given your own hard-earned money over in exchange for it. Well, hopefully it was your own money. I suppose you might have nicked it. And I have zero idea if you worked hard for it or not. This has started out well. Last but not least, hello to all the people who follow my ridiculous social media antics and want to see what the bloody hell I'm doing here. Let me introduce myself. My name is Clara, but all my friends, family, and even some of my old school teachers call me Ra. I'm 39. Yes, that's right. I will be the big 4-0 this year. In August, to be precise. I'm married to Adam and we have two children. Cressida, Cressy, 4, and Montgomery, Monty, almost 3. We chose these names for our kids because we didn't want to reinforce any middle-class stereotypes. Some of you might know me from that really grown-up app TikTok. To be honest, since the beginning of the pandemic, more grown-ups have started using it, but I can't pretend we're that grown-up on it. It's inadvertently become a big part of my life over the last 2 years, starting as a bit of escapism and then becoming a sort of job, I suppose. I'll tell you all about how I came to be introduced to it a bit later. It's not at all embarrassing. I bet you're wondering how this book came to be. No? Well, let me tell you anyway. So, when things became a bit more interesting in my life, and by interesting, I mean, instead of Metanium nappy rash ointment being top of my shopping list, I began adding wigs and costumes for my online sketches. I set about writing down snapshots of my life, reflecting on all of those ridiculous and random things that happen when you're a parent and you begin sharing your life online and, well, my weird life in general. And this book started to take shape. One thing that, for me, falls into both the ridiculous and random categories is this little thing called phonics, which takes the alphabet as we all know it and turns it into a train wreck of letters, which is then used as the basis of how kids are taught to read in primary schools. When Cressy started school and I discovered this system, my mind was so utterly blown, more on that later, that I decided this book would be structured around this word soup for no other reason than, well, it seemed like a nice idea at the time and also puns conveniently with my number one love, a crisp, cold G&T. Maybe, just maybe, you've picked up this book because you're equally interested in this bastardization of the traditional alphabet. But even if you're not, don't bloody stop listening. S is for school. Aside from my kids' entry into the weird and wonderful world of primary schools, I have my own memories by which to gauge these extraordinary places, and, albeit a massive cliche, these years were some of the greatest and most memorable of my life. My best friend of 32 years, Pip, who I met at primary school when I was 8, and I often have this conversation about how no other years in education really compare to the very formative ones. Maybe it's because we were so young that we look back on them with such fondness, whether playing hide-and-seek in the arts block or climbing trees we weren't meant to, being sent to the headmaster's office, going to the so-called haunted squash courts after school to scare ourselves shitless, counting every tiny little nerd while sharing them out between the two of us at break time. The sweets, I mean, not the boringly studious kids. That would be too weird. Lifting the lids of our old-fashioned wooden desks to check for love letters first thing in the morning. Swimming in the pool on speech day when there was no supervision. Being sent to the headmaster's office. Playing conkers and marbles, which isn't really allowed now because of health and safety. Being separated in our French lesson for giggling and being told to face each back corner of the room, which made us giggle even more uncontrollably. Being sent to the headmaster's office. Calling 192 directory inquiries from the school payphone as it was free. Asking for weird numbers in strange accents and finding it so funny we hung up until one day when they called back and threatened to call the police. Wait, what? That last one was a joke. Obviously. The teachers nicknamed Pip and I the Terrible Twins, and now I've written it down in black and white, I can see they were utterly justified. We weren't arseholes, just, as I like to put it, kids with personalities. We liked to get up to mischief. But we were never nasty and always wanted others to feel included and happy, which inevitably got them into trouble as well. But at no time were we disrespectful. Okay, maybe very occasionally to the 192 operator. Joking! That whole prank call thing was totally fabricated, okay? Didn't happen. All of us remember the little things at our primary school. I remember the smell in the corridors, having my makeup done for school plays in the dining room while eating rock cakes, which incidentally must have been made from actual rocks given that it took 36 minutes to eat one while trying not to chip a tooth. Spilling hot tea on my arm. I mean, who gives an 8-year-old tea anyway? And being told, in fact, that it was nothing a green wet paper towel couldn't sort out. But not a soft one. No, thank you. One that was akin to cardboard and felt more like sandpaper. And for goodness sake, don't make the water on it cold. Make sure it's lukewarm by the time you put it on my arm. Fast forward 28 years, and my daughter Cressy goes to a school like mine. The hallways look the same. The smell is similar. The laughter as kids run through the corridors and slow down when they see a teacher. Identical. The big oak trees lining the driveway. She even has the same chocolate sponge squares with anemic chocolate sauce, which is less like a sauce and more like a normal custard which once had a minor fling with some chocolate powder. It's still my favourite pudding, even though I've not eaten it for 23 years. I asked Cressy if she could sneak me out a square with some sauce on it next time she has it. She asked why her brother couldn't do it. Well, for one thing, Monty goes to a nursery which is at a different school to the one Cressy is at. Although, that wouldn't really matter, as I'm 100% certain he too has these chocolate puddings. I decide that his age is the issue here. Monty is only just about to turn 3. And I'm only 4. So how am I going to get the chocolate sauce out? I can't wrap it in tissue like the cake. Yes, quite. Sorry, I've not thought this one through. Cressy is learning all sorts of things at school. Maths, English, even the odd bit of French. She has music lessons and swimming lessons and, well, phonics. This should be the most basic thing for me to comprehend because, you know, they're teaching it to 4-year-olds. But I won't deny that I've found it difficult to wrap my head around. Look, I get it. At least, I get the concept. I sort of get why they do it. It even kind of makes sense. No, I'm lying. I don't get it at all. I first heard of phonics when my 10-year-old niece, Isla, started reception. I was reading with her and I said, "This starts with a B," as you would say to an adult, like B. She said, "Well, it's a B, but yes." Sorry, what? My brother Ben, B-N, explained to me that this was correct and that they now teach phonics rather than the old school alphabet. Sorry, what? The other day we got invited to a parents' evening where the teachers gave us an induction into how, what, and why they teach phonics. I was half annoyed at what I was about to hear and half utterly intrigued by what could possibly be any school's justification for not teaching actual letters of the alphabet. 10 minutes in, and I couldn't help but glance around the room to scope out what other parents might be thinking. And although there were some concrete nods of approval, I singled out 2.5 people who looked on my wavelength of slight ambiguity about the whole thing. Was anyone going to be brave enough to question further? Or were we all very Britishly going to sit there and bob our heads in time to the speech? One father put up his hand and asked, "So, when did this method of teaching come about?" "When I was at school, we learnt the letters as the normal alphabet, you know, so we knew the actual letters and how they were pronounced." "Thank you." He took the words right out of my mouth. The words I wasn't actually going to say because, well, I was too scared, but also slightly relieved that for once I wasn't that parent. The teacher said, "Oh, it's always been around." "Bollocks." Okay, sounding letters has always been a thing, but there was definitely a time when the board of something or other decided this method was going to be the one used in the official curriculum. There was a time when all schools got on board with this way of teaching and thought it would be better than the hundreds of years spent teaching it the other way, and that blows my mind. Were they like, did you see that school has started not teaching the alphabet as we know it? They are literally saying how it sounds, but not what the letter actually is. And then the other school said, "Yeah, but that's ridiculous. No way will they get anyone else to do it. I mean, it's really bad teaching, basically saying a completely different way of sounding 26 letters, which, singularly, you will never hear pronounced like that ever in your life again because, well, they're not letters. Hang on. Holy shit, look, 5 other schools have started doing it. Maybe we should too. What do you think? Are you out of your mind? They're 4 years old, not 18 months. At least, that's how I reckon it went anyway. Skip forward a year and everyone is talking to 4-year-olds at school like they're just out of the womb. But it works, somehow. I have to trust the process. What these teachers are telling me is proven, or they wouldn't do it, surely. In all seriousness, it makes sense. It makes perfect sense. But it's just odd that this is now the thing, the way. But yes, I'm obviously still struggling with it a little. I mean, the word phonics doesn't even begin with an F, for fuck's sake. Cressy arrived home with her book bag with a reading book in it and another small book inside labelled Notes from Teacher to Parent and Parent to Teacher. "What's this?" I ask. "My homework." Sorry? I thought I had at least a couple of years before this starts and now it seems I have homework too? I need to get on board with this. After all, Cressy seems incredibly enthusiastic and I should at least be grateful for that. We sit down to read. It's a very thin book. This is going to be quick and painless, I think. I turn the page to begin and see a picture. So I say, "That's nice. Let's turn to the next page and find some words to read." "Oh no, Mummy, there are no words," Cressy replies. Hang on a bloody second. At this point, I'm not sure if I'm elated by the prospect of how easy this is going to be and how little time it's going to take, or furious that the teachers have played some kind of sick joke on me. Or if they haven't played a joke, I could be enraged that we're now paying through the nose for our daughter to ultimately look at pictures in a book after we've just had a talk at the school on how phonics is an absolute necessity when learning to read. This school is quite prestigious. There must be reasoning behind this method. I make a mental note to look this up when the kids are asleep, then leave it there and continue through the book, which is akin to those I read to Cressy when she was about 10 months old, but actually less complicated, as there were actual words in those books and at least some touchy-feely sensory elements to them, which I find myself praying for on the next page to make it a little more interesting. At least, as far as I'm concerned anyway. I'm talking, as it tells me to do on the cover of the book, about everything that's going on in each picture. My worry is, though, that I have no idea what is actually going on, Luckily for me, Cressy informs me that she knows, as they have read this book at school today, twice. What the actual fuck? So, let me get this straight. My four-year-old is learning to read by sounding out letters, but not learning the letters.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.